Kvyat is pole position once again. And Lucas Wolf alongside the URD Rennsport driver. It is that is P2 on row one. There we see Felix Rosenqvist then, who's P3 on the grid. Felix Rosenqvist then, who had a fantastic result in race one earlier on, taking the win. And good grid position for Felix Rosenqvist. And alongside Rosenqvist, driver that really impressed me, Sean Hollenby, and that is Latifi, Nicholas Latifi, the Carlin driver. We should bear in mind that Kvyat then, from his pole position, once again is not in for points. There's Josh Hill. Great qualifying from Josh Hill to see him P5 on this grid.
That was Josh's best qualifying of the year, I think, so far. So a great job. And I see there, just on that picture there, he's sporting a moustache like his grandfather, Graham, there. So a little bit of the old hereditary coming through.
Eddie Cheever there, who finished P8 in the earlier race. Cheever is grid position number six.
Again, sons of famous fathers there, yep. Both ex-Formula One superstars.
Sven Müller next up then, P7. And Sven Müller in the earlier race achieved P6. The Marcon driver, Sven Müller. And there, really nice zoom in on Harry Tinknell, who's P8 on the grid. He was finished the earlier race in 12th position. As we're running through the all the drivers here, there is Jordan King, who's P9 on this grid.
But very quick in earlier today's race, finished up on the podium in third place, so he's definitely a man to look to be moving further up from that lowly P9 position there.
So we see from the back end of the grid then all the cars that are lined up, and the difference that has been made in the championship then, Raffaele Marchielli, who's starting way down the order, P16, I think. He still leads the championship on 229.5 points, but Felix Rosenqvist has eaten into that a little bit. He's on 162 now, and Rosenqvist again a long way further up the order, starting order, than Marchiello. But Marchiello did a brilliant job in race one, didn't he, Sean, in terms of minimising the points he was losing out to Felix Rosenqvist.
Yeah, definitely damage limitation there. I mean, he started 12th and finished 4th, but 3rd in the points overall. So that was a fantastic result. I think it's going to be harder today at this race, because what they've actually had now is they've had a race to collect data. A lot of the cars ahead of him would have been artificially slower than they could go, because right. The car wasn't quite set up, because we had such wet sessions yesterday.
Yes.
So I think actually it'll be harder for him now to come through from 16th up into the points, but you know, it wouldn't be the first time somebody's proved me wrong, so let's see how he gets on. But definitely Rosenqvist head and shoulders above everybody on earlier this morning. Again, they'll be getting quicker, much more on his pace than they were this morning, but I would still say that it's going to be hard to see past Rosenqvist for the win.
Now, interestingly, we all thought, and probably the teams did too, that you know, they get weather data, don't they, Sean? And you know, the forecast was for showers during the course of the day, and I think everyone thought we were lucky to get away with a dry race this morning. And lo and behold, we've got a dry race for race two this afternoon.
Quite muggy as well. Different conditions than this morning. Dry, obviously, but this morning it was quite crisp and the air was quite clean. But now it's a bit muggy. Sometimes the cars can tighten up, and a setup that would have been good for this morning's conditions wouldn't be quite the same for this afternoon.
Right.
But it'll be interesting to see. I mean, one man who will have definitely learnt from this morning is our pole sitter there, which Daniel Kvyat. Extremely fast in the wet, and has had three pole positions for these races, and came second this morning, but off the pace of Rosenqvist. But I'm sure that he'll be trying to make amends for that, and he'd love to bring home a Red Bull win in this race.
Well, it'll be, I think, from the start, the orange car that is sitting there, P3 on the grid, that all our eyes are going to be on. He was the race victor earlier on. Felix Rosenqvist, will be interesting to see what sort of a start he can get away from there. And there is... Ron Sani that we're looking at. See the names that's just on the plate behind the driver's cockpit there as we look on at the grid. Lucas Wolf then P2 on the grid. The German driver for URD Rennsport, Harald Unger, the team boss, as the cars roar away, Sean, on their formation lap.
Well, Rosenquist will be keen to replicate the start that he made this morning, because he was away and in the lead, and he really won that race in the first 100 yards, and he'll be keen to replicate that. But obviously starting one place further back. Now, that's actually quite important. He's also on the outside, so he's not in the position to be able to stick his nose in front going into the first corner unless the two guys ahead make really bad starts. But it'll be interesting to see. I think coming down to this hairpin on the first lap was where you'll see a lot of action. You know, coming into this very, very tight corner, they've got ahead, you know, got the first race of the day out of their systems, and there'll be a few guys, Wolf especially, who was looking particularly strong in the race earlier on but then dropped away and seemed to lose pace. There's, I'm sure, maybe a puncture or something like that during that race. But as you can see from the circuit there, it's quite a good series of straights there which allow these cars to tow up behind each other and make some good clean overtaking. I mean, there were a lot of overtakes this morning in that, yes, Formula 3 race, a lot more than you'd normally see in a Formula 3 race. And again, you can see the clean sky there, and the track could be a lot cleaner than it was this morning because it had rained quite heavily overnight. But there's the starting grid for this race.
Yes, it's Kvyat from Wolf, then Rosenquist, Latifi. Then we see Hill, Cheever, Muller, Tinknell, Jordan King and Michael Lewis then rounding out the first five rows of the grid. Then we see Mitch Gilbert, Lucas Auer. Then it's Nassani and Pippo Turani, Alex Lynn, Marciello down there, P16 on the grid. Giovinazzi and Tom Blomqvist, Will Buller and Mans Grenhagen then, with Sandro Zeller, Tatiana Calderon, then it's Jan Mardenborough and Andre Rudersdorf, Galliel and Vandelaar, Soralis and Spike Goddard, Richard Goddard at the back of the pack, the snow-capped peaks there that we can see, and a good crowd in here for day one of the race weekend to watch the action. They've seen some great racing, haven't they?
Yes, definitely. I mean, there's a huge queue coming into the circuit first thing this morning. The Austrian fans obviously really love their motorsport, and you know, with the nice weather bringing them out as well. But the drivers here trying to get a lot of heat into the tyres and the brakes. Very important for those first couple of corners, especially they're quite tight, especially the hairpin, to have a good feel of the brakes. And the driver's lining up there. Again, Rosenquist slightly back from his line, but I'm sure he'll make up for that with a fantastic start. But you can see there, quite a bit warmer than it was this morning, yes, probably about 5 degrees, both track and air temperature, than it was first thing this morning.
So they peel off and occupy their grid slots, ready for race two of the three Formula 3 European Championship races that we've got here this weekend at Spielberg. All the information that you could find on the website is on FIAF3Europe.com. That is the website to go to. We'll bring the lights up into the screen for you so you can see the lights come on, go out, and then we will be away and racing. Okay, so the revs rise, so does the excitement and the anticipation as five lights go on. Lights go out and we're away and racing. Good start there, I think, from Rosenquist. He seemed to get away nicely.
Yeah, and the pole man has, the pole man's dropped a bit there as well. So Wolf got the best of the getaway. So not initially, but possibly there, maybe Mr. Gear or something like that.
So a few of the cars running wide there. And interestingly, from one of the previous races, some of the curbing has been moved from there. But Rosenquist already is trying on a charge, isn't he, to try and put his nose in front. And has he done enough here?
I think he has. He's just pushed ahead there of Wolf, but Wolf will be keen just to stick with him because he didn't have the pace this morning. It looks like, yes, definitely, Wolf actually looked like he got pushed very wide at the hairpin. I'd love
Kvyat
to see
it. Gone through into second place, so that's, it's right, Rosenquist that's leading. It's Kvyat in second place now. Then it's Lucas Wolf. He's still hung out to dry on the outside there. Is he going to be able to tuck back in just before we get to Latifi?
Yeah, Latifi's looking strong there as well. But Wolf looked like he must have got pushed wide at that hairpin. Again, he's looking to try and get back into second place, but desperately defending third at the moment, as we've got a repeat of race one where Rosenquist has said, thank you and good night, I'll see you in about 24 laps.
Yeah, well, he did exactly what he needed to do. So as the rest of them come through, reasonably good start. No dramas on the first couple of corners.
Yes, and Marciello hasn't had any problems and just trying to pick him out there. See, as again, being pushed very wide. That's Tinknell being pushed wide, I think, there.
It's Jordan King going through, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I think so. So then, first lap is completed in the order of Rosenquist, Kvyat. Well, then it's a Wolf, Lennis, Latifi, Muller, Hill, Cheever.
Marcello's actually lost two or three places on that first lap there, as we have a bit of side-by-side action at the first corner, running very wide, but not losing too much time. But this is going to be much harder, I think, for Marcello. Everybody's got up to speed, the cars are up to speed, and he's going to be struggling to fight his way through, as he did earlier on.
Yes, you did predict that it wasn't going to be as easy for him as they go three abreast here. And Pippo Durrani there in the mix, right at the front of that pack, I think it was. Still, they continue to charge. Thankfully, no dramas in the early stages of this race that we've seen so far. Marcello got a real, challenge ahead of him now to minimise, as you've said, Sean, its damage limitation with regard to points, isn't it? Because Felix Rosenquist is 1.5 seconds up the road already.
Yes, that's right. He's looking very strong. Now, the difficulty now is that the cars really are very much up to speed. There's the leader pulling away. And again, Kvyat is doing a great job there. Also, Josh Hill hanging in there as well. So there's a few guys there who are looking for their best results of the season, just to keep in amongst it. And there's Oya, who made a little bit of a mistake earlier on by squeezing a car wide and finishing off the track. Got back up into the points in 10th place. But he definitely had the pace to run at the front in that earlier race. So it'll be interesting to see how he gets on over the full race distance.
OK, so Rosenquist then from Kvyat. Then it's Wolf, then it's Nicholas Latifi, then it's Muller, then it's Josh Hill, then it's Cheever, then it's Auer, King and Tinknell rounding out the top ten as we see a move on here. As that's Lucas Auer going through on Cheever. Did he make that stick?
I think he did, yes, but just ahead of, just behind them there, this, again, they're looking very tight. That's Oya again, still trying to make that move stick on Cheever.
Jordan King is just waiting to pick up, isn't he? He's just waiting to pounce if they should come to grief there. And he has, hasn't he?
Yes, that's right. I mean, there's sensible driving there from King. I mean, he drove fantastic well in that first race just to pick up places and finish up on the podium. And again, looking further back in the field. Yeah, that's right. I think the team owners on the radio making sure that all his boys play nicely together.
Motorsport orange liveried cars there, as we see a replay here of there was the beneficiary of that, if you like, and that was Jordan King, wasn't it?
Yes, that's right. And again, you can see there's Cheever trying to hang out around the outside, but gets pushed wide quite fairly, and King says, thanks very much, I'll take that position from you, and let's have a go and see if we can follow up through the field.
So Rosenquist, Kvyat, Wolf, then the 1, 2, 3, as the rest of the pack come piling through here, and whichever way you look at the moment, it's a streaming grid of Formula 3 cars and some brilliant race action. We just saw Marcello in shot there. Marcello at the moment, just looking down the order, here's down to P18.
Yeah, he's not making any progress at all, and I've got to say, based on his lap times, I don't think he will be either, because he's got cars who are very similarly paced to him just in front of him. Maybe a long next 20 laps, maybe, if the car becomes a little bit stronger over a race distance. But I don't see him getting up into the top 10 or anything like P4 like he had earlier on today.
So we're on lap 3 of 24 of this second of the Formula 3 races, the three Formula 3 races, as we saw Mans Groningen there. Second of the three races across the weekend. Here's a replay of the start. Go down the grid, the lights go out, and Rosenquist got a good start, didn't he?
Yeah, that's right. I was interested to see what happens to Kvyat, because he got a good getaway, but then seemed to lose time there, just in that little gap in those two shots. I would expect him to be in the lead going into the first corner, but sort of dropped back to third place. But Wolf got a fantastic getaway, and as you can see here, Rosenquist is already looking to get past. He's eager to get away, so he's not tagged by anybody behind, and definitely has the pace. Puts his nose up the inside there of Wolf, and exiting this, I'm sure that he pushes Wolf wide, because Wolf loses a lot of time coming out of that hairpin.
Camera quite wasn't where we needed to see it, was it? Unfortunately,
no, that's right. That's the thing. Wolf gave him room, and again, we got a battle going on here.
This is Sven Muller on Latifi, and and Sven Müller down there currently is P5, Latifi P4, and Latifi spent quite a lot of time this morning having to defend, didn't he, Sean? But
yes, that's right. I mean, he defended very well the first half of the race, and then was able to squeak away and pull further again. But again, he's up ahead of Müller. Again, Müller was very quick in this morning's race, so this is back in fourth and fifth place.
Müller right alongside now, and this is it. Side by side they are, but Latifi has got the advantage at the moment, but Sven Müller is certainly keeping him keen all the way around this track at the moment. This is the battle then for P4 in this F3 race that we're watching here at Spielberg. And there's Latifi going through, and that is the man that he's really challenging at the moment. It's Sven Müller, the German driver from Marcon Motorsport team, who is pushing very, very hard. Just in the background, you can see Lucas Auer there as well in car number 24. But Latifi at the moment seems to have the measure of him.
Yes, that's right. I mean, very strong the whole race distance last time, Latifi, and Müller was as well. But Auer should have the pace of these two ahead. He's slightly quicker as we look back further through the field. Interesting to see where Marciello's... Has he got himself any further? No, he hasn't. Still in P18. This isn't looking good for him. His championship lead is going to be desperately eroded in this if it carries on in this sort of vein. And I can see that, you know, if it happens in the next race again tomorrow, then you're looking at, you know, possibly a new championship leader. But, again, this battle here with Latifi, again, very good defending. Always puts his car in a good position. We saw it earlier on when he was defending, didn't put a foot wrong, and then just managed to pull away when he had the break.
Now Müller is right alongside him, and they are neck and neck going into the next turn, but Latifi has got the advantage there, hasn't he? Müller's got to go the long way round there, and as you say, absolutely fair and fine fight that's going on at the moment. Of course, whilst they're battling, Lucas Auer is being able to get on terms, Sean, isn't he?
Yes, that's right. I mean, especially out of that corner, if you put yourself on the outside, you can't put the power down until the guy in front of you allows you to, and Latifi seems to be excellent at just timing it perfectly just so the guy behind loses as much time as possible. And again, going wide on the second to last corner, looks like his front nose, oh no, the front nose is there, but
that's Marciello.
That's terrible. That's not what this team would be wanting to see. He's probably lost two or three places there, and definitely that won't done the performance of the car any good at all.
So Rosenqvist, Kvyat, Wolf, Latifi from Müller, then it's Auer and Hill and King. And now we can see Auer really is on the back of Sven Müller. Marciello then, just saw why he's down there in P18, didn't we? And that's not good news for his charge at the championship. Had a huge lead going into this weekend. That lead has been eroded slightly as we're watching this battle that is continuing to rage over P4 position in this race. There's three cars really, really close together there. Latifi, Müller and Lucas Auer as well. And they're all jostling and diving from side to side and beginning to move into that battle now as well is Josh Hill.
And Muller's done a good move there, pushed Latifi tight so that he couldn't be pushed out wide, and then tried to make the cut back, which is he's worked, but what he's actually done is allowed Auer maybe a little bit of room, but again, he has left him just that inch of room there, which has allowed Latifi to squeak away. But again, Auer hasn't made the best of it, but that's allowed Josh Hill.
Is he going to be the beneficiary here? Because he's looking at these three battling. He's been able to get on terms with them now, hasn't he? Now, to be fair, he's got the very, very racy and lively King right behind him as well. And all of a sudden, the pack of three becomes a pack of five.
Yes, that's right. And Müller is getting a little bit frustrated, I think. He's being held up by Latifi. But now he's got to catch back up to him again because he was trying to be sort of strong-arm him a little bit into the coming out of the hairpin last time. But Latifi seems quite cool. He seems quite cool under pressure. Doesn't seem to get fazed having cars alongside him, sort of trying to bang wheels with him, and just holds his place and said, well, you've got to wait for me because I'm in front.
Yeah, that was certainly the case this morning, wasn't it? He didn't fail under that pressure, did he?
No, that's right. I mean, again, he if anybody, the person who looks like he might make a mistake is Müller as he gets more frustrated. And again, it just comes up very close behind. And then you've got Auer and Hill who are looking to pounce as well. But let's see how we get on here. Again, Latifi holds the inside line, which makes Müller go round the outside. But again, you can get half a car's length ahead as he is here. But I don't think it's going to be enough because Latifi just breaks very late. But actually...
Now what that's done is they go three abreast there. That has played it. Oh, and we are this contact there, Sean.
Yeah, Latifi again breaks himself a little bit late there. Three into one, don't go, and he just speared himself off over to the left. very difficult there because Muller was trying. Oh, there we go, and that is
Muller's
that
out.
Is Muller out as
yeah,
well.
Muller's out.
So the big beneficiary there is Hoyer and Hill.
Oh, you can see the frustration in the cockpit there, and Muller's, he is absolutely fuming. Well, you can spin all you want, Nicholas. That ain't going anywhere, is it?
No, that's right. And it'll be interesting to see again exactly who made any moves. I, to be honest with you, they all looked like they didn't do anything particularly wrong. It was just a case of it was a long curving right-hander, and there were three of them trying to all take the place at the same time.
Now there's the Prima Power team down there. Now here it is. Talk us through this, Sean.
Yeah, so we've got Muller, who's nearly a car's width ahead. Latifi locks up, they bang wheels, and then you've got Hoyer down the inside. So they a little bit of banging wheels there. Latifi staying in the middle. Oh, to be honest with you, Muller's got his hands in the air waving at people. Just concentrate on what you're doing. And it, really, he could have got the run down the inside to the next corner, really. But, you know, the typical case of not quite enough room. Again, locks the inside front wheel, bangs wheels with Muller. Muller's unaware that Hoyer's coming down the inside. Waves his hands in the air like he just doesn't care. And there goes Latifi off to the left-hand side. But again, breaks the front suspension on Muller's car. It's a shame because definitely, oh, I think Muller had the pace there. And again, another angle here as we come. They're banging wheels with each other.
You're right, his hands
and
out
then,
the cockpit.
There we go.
It?
Oh, actually, it looks maybe a little bit like Muller came across to the right on him, in fairness. I don't know. I think the stewards will have a little look at that. Muller was busy waving his hands, and I think he might have got a little bit aggravated. In fairness, Latifi didn't look like he pushed over on him. It just looked like he was making space for Hoyer, who was on the inside, on the right-hand side. But obviously, Muller wouldn't have known that.
But, of course, Latifi had locked up, hadn't he? So he was... I don't know.
It happens. It happens. When you're trying that hard, a little error can end up in a big mistake, and that's exactly what happened there.
Well, that has changed the order somewhat because it's Rosenqvist now. Certainly hasn't changed anything for him. He's 4 seconds up the road. As we see the Marcon driver there. Clearly Sven not happy, but it's Rosenqvist, Kvyat, then it's Lucas Wolff, then it's Auer, then it's Josh Hill now up into P5. King and Tinkle 6 and 7 with Cheever P8. Blomqvist 9 and Michael Lewis in P10.
It's quite interesting there to see the two personalities of those two drivers. You've got Latifi, who looked like he was super, super calm, just having a walk in the Styrian countryside. And you've got Muller still with his helmet on, shouting at somebody unknown. He's not plugged into the car, it wasn't his team, so it's just himself. And in fairness, I think if we look back at that, you might actually see that it might be Muller's fault that accident happened. But again, more battles further down the field. Same corner, let's see if these guys can make it happen without ending up in the tire wall. But yes, that looks nice and calm. But it's interesting because that was actually replayed in the track, whereas Latifi was defending fairly calmly. Okay, he made the incident when he locked up his wheel, but was able to put his car in the right place, possibly slightly at the wrong time the last time. But whereas Muller was getting really aggravated and throwing his car about, which the driver's personality really comes across when you're in motor racing, and part of the learning process is to be able to calm that personality down so that you can channel your speed and your aggression positively rather than negatively.
OK, so the battle we're watching at the moment then is Gilbert, Lynn, Nissani and Marciello then. It's 12, 13, 14 and 15th place. Yellow flag.
Right, they're somewhere on the track. Again, he's gained three places in that, a couple of those obviously from the incident, but again, not looking very strong. His lap time's slightly quicker than the cars ahead, but not enough just to be marching through the field. So his team will be very busy in between this race and the next. And again, we've got towing up to the hairpin. And again, side by side, there's a car gone wide at the hairpin, but we had that two cars going side by side coming into there just behind Marciello. And again, they're still at it behind. You can see guys ducking left and right behind. As we've got Lynn with Nissani right up the back of him there, looking for a way past. And again, but his chance at overtaking is now allowing Marciello to have a look at sneaking a place. But again, every point will be important here for Marciello to get up there and further protect a decreasing championship lead.
Okay, so Marciello is at the back of that pack as we watch Roy Nissani, or the back end of Roy Nissani, then just going through on a shot there. Cars come through. Dennis Vandalar and Giovinazzi we saw there. There's Sean Galliel. So it's Rosenqvist from Kvyat, Wolff, Auer, Hill, King, Tingle and Cheever.
So a bit of contact here.
Dennis van der Laar then and Giovinazzi very, very close together there.
And that's Marcello just taking a place from Nassani there as they come. Nassani desperately trying to get back across but hasn't quite managed to do that. He's lost two places with that one move there. So Marcello's starting to match, sort of march on a little bit, and maybe with a bit of clear air he'll be able to take a few more places and maybe get up into the points further.
Well, maybe so. Jan Mardenborough, we saw there just a moment ago.
I mean, he's quite an incredible story, really, because he was the winner of the Nissan PlayStation Academy. As he's desperately defending there and pressing the cross and the square buttons really hard on that steering wheel, I'm sure, to defend. A fantastic thing for PlayStation to give somebody who's literally been racing just on his PlayStation.
Yes.
But to suddenly get in amongst international Formula, last year racing in GTs and Nissan, GTR, and now into Formula 3 and showing really well.
Yesterday
he was very quick. I mean, this is a quality field, and for somebody with really just, you know, 1 or 2 years racing experience under his belt, it's great to see him doing so well.
Half distance then, Rosenqvist, Kvyat, Wolf, Auer, the 1-2-3-4 with Josh Hill, then it's King, then it's Tignall, then it is Cheever, P8. You can see Blomqvist, Lewis, Durrani, Gilbert, Lynn, Marcello, then P14, then it's Mardenborough and Nissani.
And slightly behind the front three, Josh Hill put a particularly slower lap than he has been doing there, and that's allowed King to close up. And they come down to the hairpin here.
There we can see Alex Lynn and that was Mitchell Gilbert. Battle going on there between Gilbert and Lynn. It's down there in where are we? P12, isn't it? Oh, just look, you really see in the cockpit there as Mitch Gilbert looked to his side.
And there was a little bit of contact there, very similar to the incident earlier on. I shouldn't think Lynn's too happy with that, to be honest, because he gave him room and Gilbert locked up, tagged his right rear wheel. Possibly, you know, that's the sort of contact that induces a puncture. And we should get another view of it here. Again, locks the inside. Lynn gives him just enough room, I would have thought, but just slightly tagged. I shouldn't think he's very happy about that, but lives to fight another day. And further back in the field, again, more contact there.
It's Giovinazzi.
Yeah, just getting tagged at the hairpin.
Tagged by Dennis van der Laar there. And whilst that's going on, of course, playing into the hands and the advantage of those that sit just behind.
And there's Rosenqvist who, first time we've had a look at him for about 10 laps, I think.
To be fair, he's 5.5 seconds up the road, isn't he? Just see Peter Mucha there. There he is with the headphones on. Motorsport, well, to be fair, it's playing out nicely for them for that team, isn't it?
Yes, that's right. And I think he's conserving his pace here, because earlier on in the day he had a half a second to a second every lap over people behind him, and now I think he's just stroking it home, really. I mean, the gap back to Kvyat is similar. Having said that, he's just set the fastest for a second sector, Rosenqvist, so he's not cruising quite as much as I thought he was. But Kvyat's getting another good result. Again, limited experience with the Russians, so it's good to see. You know, again, Russia is going to be a massive force in motorsport over the next 5 years. And I think Red Bull see that, and they want a Russian name to wave the flag for Red Bull in the Soviet Union, or the old Soviet Union.
So Rosenqvist, Kvyat then, as we watch Kvyat across the line, then it's Wolf in P3 now. For the benefits of the championship, Kvyat is effectively invisible, isn't he? The DTM stars looking on as well, keeping a close eye on what goes on in F3. So Rosenqvist, Kvyat, Lenz Wolf, Kassauer, Josh Hill, Jordan King, Harry Tignall, Cheever, then Blomqvist, then Lewis into the top 10.
Josh Hill and Oyer are starting to get a replay here. And that was Giovanni, is it?
Yeah, who's just here? Giovinazzi,
who's just skipped wide. Quite a quick corner there, so he'd have been hanging on to try and get it very easy to end up in the gravel as we go back here. But a couple of drivers on the move, Oyer and Hill, they've got the pace to catch Wolf now, and they seem to be closing. Not too many laps to go. There's 10 laps to go, though. That's enough time for those fourth and fifth place drivers to start closing in on, and possibly get a podium. Again, also important to remember that Kvyat here is an invitation driver, so he doesn't score points for the main championship. So a fourth place is good enough for third place points. But what they all want to do is they all want to get up on that podium. So I'd expect that battle for third place to hot up over the next four or five laps.
Well, Michael Lewis is looking very racy there as he's hounding at the moment.
And they're showing a drive-through penalty there for one of the drivers, possibly for using too much track, which is a common thing nowadays, using too much track and gaining an advantage. And there's the driver coming through the pits at the moment, who's number 19.
It's Grenhagen.
Grenhagen. So it doesn't affect the front runners, but you know, won't be very popular. No respect of yellows is the reason there. So that was something that was happening yesterday in the practice sessions, and also a couple of drivers fell foul of that this morning in the first race as well. So to be honest with you, it's very, very important. Quite a big story, obviously, in DTM with Gary Paffett and a few other drivers suffering from that. But very important to respect the yellows. You absolutely do not know what's around the corner, so you've got to be careful. But you know, you always feel a bit sorry for these guys because they could have lifted off and not been seen to slow down. But back with the battle here again. Nassani
we're watching there, and Nassani is down there in 16th place at the moment.
Yeah, not far ahead of him in that gaggle is Marcello again, who's again not making any sort of progress in the race, which I am surprised about because he looked very strong this morning. There's another drive-through penalty for Mardenborough, a non-respect of yellow flags, similar thing again. So again, we'll be looking to him to take his drive-through penalty, and he has to do it within three laps, so this will possibly be the second. Yeah, here he comes. Comes in first again. Won't be very happy about it, but you know, it's important that these rules are there to for the safety of the drivers, but also the marshals who are out there on the circuit who make the whole racing scene happen. Without them,
I was going to say, we wouldn't go
they wouldn't
racing.
Be racing.
Would we?
No. Yeah, that's right. So the prime importance there is the safety of the marshals. Another driver looks like another drive-through penalty. Giovinazzi Nuzzi, who we just saw going wide on the previous lap. So. These drivers you've got to look at, and another one as well. So
yeah, coming through is Van der Laar now.
Right, okay.
So yes, there's a bit of a queue there for a minute, wasn't there?
Yes, that's right. So that battle for third place is the next couple of laps.
No, that's Van der Laar's in for something else.
Wing failure. So he's maybe tagged someone. Did we see him do that earlier on? But it's quite easy to hit a curb particularly hard, and that'll break your front nose cone quite easily. But oh, here we go. This is the contact there. There we go. We saw that incident earlier on, but we didn't. That's right.
Yep.
We didn't see the wing damage there. But yeah, that's sort of. It won't be the end of his race, but it definitely be the end of any chance of serious points in this event for him.
So then, whilst we've been watching the activity through the pit lane, Rosenqvist then increases his lead up to 7.1 seconds over Daniel Kvyat. Then it's Wolf, then it's Lucas Auer, then Josh Hill in P5 with King P6, Ticknell P7, Blomqvist is up to P8 with Cheever 9, and Michael Lewis in P10. We're on lap 17 of 24 here at the Spielberg Circuit. Marcello then still down there in P14.
Yeah, not making any sort of progress there. Lap time very similar to the cars ahead of him.
That's Sorales who's got a drive-through penalty. So Felix Sorales, the non-respect of yellow flags. A number have been nabbed for that, haven't they, Sean? As you say, it happened in. Knocking them down the order, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, it ruins their race. That's the end of their race in such a short race as this. If it was a three-hour GT race, they could make up for it and go from there. But there's no chance of it in this sort of race here. Pace is. Oyer and Hill are still closing in on Wolf in third place, and Hill is getting quicker and quicker. He just did his PB on the previous lap, so he's fifth, but I would expect them to be a bit of a last lap bun fight for third place, I would expect.
Yes, Rosenqvist last lap. Rosenqvist is just on a charge, isn't he, to increase his cushion as we see That's Lucas Auer, and that's just what he needed not to be doing, frankly, isn't it?
No, that's right. And he dropped a bit of time to Hill, obviously, there, who was in fifth place, but also lost time to Wolff in third place. But this... you've got Lewis still pressuring.
He is pushing Cheever, isn't he? Yep. So Michael Lewis in the orange car, Eddie Cheever in front then. Cheever is P9, Lewis P10.
I think with Michael Lewis as well, we saw it last year, he races a lot better than he qualifies, and he is a good racer. You can see there the car dancing on the edge of adhesion as he's on the brakes. Maybe lost a little bit of time to Cheever that time. But a good racing driver, and it'd be interesting to see if somebody could look into his data and see if there's anything they can do to maybe just squeak a little bit more time under qualifying. But definitely knows how to race a car.
Yes, we're watching Michael Lewis then, the American driver in P10 in the orange car. Right in the middle of your shot there, chasing down Eddie Cheever, who is currently P9. Michael Lewis following in every wheel track, isn't he? And there the team look on, see how their drivers are performing out there. Rosenqvist, of course, doing a great job for them up front, with some 7.5 second lead over Kvyat in second place. Michael Lewis is not seeming to be able to encroach too far onto the back of Cheever at the moment. Although as they take the run up the hill here, he's able to feel like close enough to.
Might get a good run here, though.
This is fairly quick. It's very uphill here, isn't it?
They get a good toe down there, so he's maybe not quite close enough to have a dive up the inside, but he's very late on the brakes, but the battle just behind them.
So going through there is Alex Lynn on the undercut. Surely Pippo Durrani is good. No, I don't think he is. So this is between Pippo Durrani then.
And Alex Lynn was very... Oh, contact there, Lynn and Durrani. That'll probably be a safety car, I would think. But again, two drivers, plenty of room there. So they move around and then not quite sure where the other car is. That's the problem. I mean, there was no need for that. Unfortunate, because Durrani gave him room at the hairpin.
Yes.
Then Lynn didn't cut back across him. But then again, where you can see there, the road sweeps left and right, both jostling for position to try and get a good point to maybe break there. Again, there's the safety car there. I saw Alex Lynn moving there. There's Alex Lynn getting out again. Good to see the driver getting out there. But a tricky part of the circuit there, because you've got lots of undulation. It's not very nice to be getting out there. And there's front damage there for Durrani on the left. Be interested to see if we've got a higher view of that, to see who didn't give who room, or whether it was six or one and a half dozen the other. But again, a bit of a shame. What that will do, though, you've got Rosenqvist now, who's going to be caught up. Seems to have the pace, but what he may have now, possibly he's used all his tyres, and it'll allow the cars behind to have a little go. So again, here's the incident made for a different angle. So again, Lynn dives up the inside. Durrani gives him room, cuts back,
yep.
Gets a clean acceleration. They both give each other room there. So, there's... So this is it here. So there's plenty of room between them coming up. Yeah, it looks like Lynn moves across, in fairness. But, neither of them giving each other room. But it looked like Durrani possibly quite close to the edge of the track, so he didn't have a lot of room to give, really. But... again, difficult to see from that angle exactly what's what. But again, it's Formula 3. These guys are still learning a lot about how to race wheel to wheel and give each other room, which is the key thing. If you end up bumping into each other, that's what happens, and you don't score any points by finishing the Armco.
No. They're good to see him getting out.
But yes, yeah.
Wasn't so good to see a car coming into shot any moment now as he was trying to get out, which concerned me somewhat, but there it is.
No, exactly, that's right. I mean, they're very strong cars, these. That Dallara, that they are, they've been the Formula 3 stable car for over 10 years now, I think, maybe even more than that. And they do know, they have to make a very strong car. Yeah, and red flag there as well. That was quite a big impact. I wouldn't be surprised if there's a little bit of damage to the Armco as well. And again, Lynn just having a little think about his afternoon.
So how would you call that, Sean?
In fairness, difficult to say, because you could look at it from a different angle and it could look completely different. I would say it's a racing incident in a difficult situation where, you know, that they've driven sensibly earlier on, so you'd probably err on the side of they're saying they were driving sensibly afterwards. But it did look, if anything, that Lynn moved slightly across on Durrani, and Durrani said, no, I'm not moving out of the way here, which, you know, is his right to do. But then it ends up that you don't end up finishing the race. So it's a learning curve for these guys, and they'll have both learned a lesson from that.
Costly lesson, looks like.
It is, unfortunately. So that's a big, hefty shunt, and not what either of them needed in the sort of the Saturday afternoon. I'm sure their team were a bit disappointed, because that means they've got a long night ahead of them mending that car.
Where are we at then? Rosenqvist, Kubiak, Wolf, the 1-2-3. Now, interestingly, Rosenqvist has perhaps got more of a points advantage over that than he did this morning, because Marcello down there in P11. As we see this again,
there's a slightly higher view, but it was a little bit early in the shot, really. Yeah, yes, that's right. And I couldn't quite see from there. Wouldn't mind seeing that quite early on, nice and slow, just to see what's happening. But there's slight movement from Lynn across, trying to desperately get across. But, you know, at the end of the day, it was very important to get that inside line. So Durrani was keen on hanging in there, really. But again, you can see the front damage there. We've clipped that side of it. Front suspension is badly bent there. That'll be the end of but not too bad. The chassis won't be damaged. It's literally a couple of uprights and wishbones, probably push rod on there as well. Definitely a push rod on. But here's the man of the moment, Rosenqvist. He seems to be in a different class to everybody else this weekend so far. Nobody really seems to have an answer to him at the moment. Despite not getting the jump at the start as he did at the last race, he was still able to pick his gap and just power his way through and really open up a gap that he can control at will.
And he did, didn't he? Finishing some 7.6 seconds up the road from Kvyat in second place, and Wolf in P3. So as they head off up towards the podium then, race finishing not in the way that we would like it to, Sean, but I think absolutely right within the time frame left that they had an alternative to red flag that, really.
Yeah, it'd be interesting from Oyer and Hill's point of view, because they were catching quite considerably on third place Wolf there, and I'm sure that they would have been confident of maybe battling for that podium position and really with the pace they had, possibly getting ahead of Wolf before the end. But that's the thing, you've got to be in the position, you know, red flags can happen at any point, and you've got to make the most of that situation.
So then they'll be heading up off towards the podium, and once again the big crowd here on day one of this race weekend has seen some scintillating Formula 3 action, and here is the result then. Felix Rosenqvist taking the win. Daniel Kvyat in second place, Lucas Wolf third, Lucas Auer in P4 with Josh Hill P5, Jordan King 6, Harry Tinknell 7, Tom Blomqvist 8, Eddie Cheever 9, and Michael Lewis 10th with there. Raffaele Marchiello down 11 with the rest of the drivers coming through. Mitch Gilbert, Roy Nassani, Will Buller, Galliel, Riddersdorf, Goddard, and all the others there, as you can see on screen in front of you. So, podium to come. More information at FIAF3Europe.com, which contains all the information you could possibly need about the Formula 3 European Championship. The FIA Formula 3 European Championship, as we see some slow-mos then of our pole sitters. Here's Lucas Wolf then. There is Daniel Kvyat, who takes P2. Success of earlier today, Felix Rosenqvist, the Mucha Motorsport driver, then taking the win in race two, the FIA Formula 3 European Championship here at Spielberg. And we'll be heading off up to the podium after these slow-mo highlight shots of the podium cars. And a very happy looking Peter Mucha, Sean.
set up a car there that's head and shoulders above the rest of the field, and Rosenqvist is using his experience to the most and really making the most of it. But that's what a champion will do. So I would say that this weekend, if he wins this championship at the end of it, this will be the weekend that turns it around for him. And Marcello will rue that wet qualifying session yesterday.
Yes, I think you're right. So we can see them behind the scenes then in the podium prep area. As they head off towards the podium. And, this is a fantastic showcase for these guys here in Austria, isn't it, Sean?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is why we mentioned earlier on why the championship, the European Formula 3 Championship, is so strong, because they're racing in front of the people who can make a difference to their careers. There's always somebody from the Formula 1 world hanging around the DTM paddock, whether it's Dr. Helmut Marko for Red Bull or various others. But what they can also do, if the career route doesn't look to be happening in Formula 1, there's also a DTM route, which we've seen with Wehrlein, this who was racing Formula 3 against Rosenqvist last year, who's jumped up to the DTM. And that's as probably a better chance of making a career in DTM than they have in Formula 1, because it truly is a manufacturer sport where you can actually get paid to go racing. Formula 1, you've got to bring huge... bundle a dosh along to get yourself in the seat, whereas DTM, is a chance to let these young boys make a career in motorsport, which is, is fantastic. And the manufacturers BMW, Mercedes, and Audi should be congratulated for that.
See Stefan the Voice there, just in the background, who's getting ready for this podium presentation for us. And there is Felix Rosenqvist then. Quite as delighted as I thought he might actually.
Well, I think when you win one earlier in the day and you've had a nice easy day in the office, you're not quite as ecstatic if you've been batting wheel to wheel for 24 laps. But the wins will come, the points still count the same whether you've worked hard for it or not. He's done a great job in that race and done exactly what he did. And really, that puts the pressure back on Marcello.
It really does.
If you think about the third race tomorrow, he'll be thinking, right, I've really got to make it. And that's when the mistakes happen, when you really are trying to push. At the start of the day, he wasn't under that sort of pressure.
Okay, so they head out towards the podium then. So Felix Rosenqvist heads up to the top spot. Daniel Kvyat then. And then Lucas Wolf.
Man würde sagen, eigentlich hier in der Nähe von Graz ready to race. Aber das ist nicht KTM, es ist Mücke.
This is now for the national anthem, once again for Felix Rosenqvist.
Der wird gleich sein Samtus walten. Zunächst aber mal, zum zweiten Mal, die schwedische Nationalhymne für Felix den glücklichen Rosenqvist.
Trophies then, and Felix Rosenqvist holds it aloft. As you said, Sean, good day at the office for him today.
And Kvyat's been very impressive. Again, there's a team trophy. I mean, again, Macca Motorsports must take a lot of credit for those two race wins today for Rosenqvist. But Kvyat's been impressive as well for a relatively lack of, inexperienced Formula 3-wise. He's done a great job. Wet yesterday, which, could have said, well, the quick in the wet, but not necessarily today. But he's had the pace to hold on to second place. Sensible, didn't try to over-defend from Rosenqvist earlier on, and just brought the car home in second place. Good lessons learned there for him. And also Wolf, who showed good pace earlier on in the earlier day's race, but has now converted that into a podium position. So good stuff for him as well.
So all move in then for the obligatory media photographs.
interesting. I've just seen the results change where they've it's put Durrani and Lynn back in front of Marcello, which I think will further hurt, because he was shown, Marcello was earlier on shown in 11th place, but now he's shown down back in 13th, which will extend the gap points-wise even further. So, you know, a double blow there. I'm not quite sure how that works, because I thought, of course, the red flag that it would be included in the results, but I'm sure it's been much clever than me working that sort of thing. Yes, Rosenqvist, again, couldn't do much better. Earlier on, a great job. Didn't gain the points advantage over Marcello that he was hoping, but definitely that race, Marcello has dropped a long way back, and it'll be interesting to see what the points are. But here's the final result.
And a confirmation of the result then, Rosenqvist taking the win from Daniel Kvyat, Lucas Wolff then P3, Lucas Auer 4, Josh Hill 5, Jordan King P6, then Harry Tinknell, Tom Blomqvist, Eddie Cheever and Michael Lewis then getting P10 in that race. Then we see Pippo Durrani P11, with Alex Lynn P12. Then it's Marcello pushed now back down to P13, Mitch Gilbert, Nassani, Buller, Galliel and Rudersdorf, Goddard and Sandro Zeller, P20. So, yeah, interesting that. But as you say, Sean, things can be changed, can't they, after the race?
Yes, that's right. I think they'll have a little look at those results and see what's going on. But it will make quite a bit of difference poise-wise, because he's only at the bottom of the points scoring there, Marcello, so it makes quite a bit of difference whether he actually scores any or not. So it'll be interesting to see if anything goes on post-race on that one, but I'm sure we get the points as they stand any minute. But definitely Rosenqvist will have dragged himself much closer onto the back of the Prema Power team car of Marcello.
So as we see, very satisfied Peter Booker walking away then from his podium. Seeing his podium celebrations for the second time today here at Spielberg, and that was some interesting tradition on grid.
I used to have a shirt like that back in 1975.
Still got a pair of shorts. Like sorry, everyone. Didn't mean that. So there we are. We are just waiting for this points graphic to come up. And I suspect they're still computing quicker than we are using our calculator to try and suss the points at the end of this. In some of the highlights of the preps on the grid then.
Right, big heavy hit there. Again, when he watched it back again, he went backwards quite hard. That would have done a lot of damage to the back of the car, and we'll need a complete strip down to the bare chassis, I would think, to get it ready for tomorrow.
Start-finish line. We're on the approach to the start-finish line. There, it's Rosenqvist, Lucas Wolff, and then the Muck and Motorsport team there. Labours here at Spielberg. Still the dark clouds loom overhead, but